All right, so let's jump back into this thing here. Couple things. Where's David? David. David's like, yeah. Oh, just David. That's your name. So you guys read Twitter, so I'm reading the tweets here. David puts on there. Mark, yes, Jenny's number is 867-5309. Should begin the process for you guys to define and determine what your culture is and who you are and what the expectations are of this organization. You have high standards. Now, I'm going to say this in a way that I don't want to make it sound like Mark Newton's high and mighty, but I have very high standards when it comes to the way I live my life. I have very high standards for my kids. I think some days that, like my girls, have never dated. They're 22 and 20 years old, have never had a date. Now, that might be because I'm a little bit overbearing or protective dad, but I like to believe that it's because I think my girls have a high standard when it comes to the guys that they would select. Not that they haven't been interested in dating, don't get me wrong, because I hear about it all the time. Now, I don't say that in a braggadocious way, like I'm some kind of great super parent or that my kids are the most wonderful kids, whatever. My hope is that's the reason why, is because they have a standard that they're saying not anybody has come in, not anybody's clicked on the web page and met the expectations of what the culture is that I want. Plus, they're in college and they're playing volleyball and they don't have time for boys. I mean, they have time for boys, but you know, they don't have time to date. But again, please don't misunderstand that as any kind of a superiority by any means. I hope that my kids have that kind of standards that they're willing to. Because the selection process, guess what? When it comes to hiring people, should be the same selection process we should encourage in our kids when it comes to dating and marriage and all those kind of things. I like to think that my wife is really good at the selection process. I like to think that. I think she's just kind of grown into the culture and the standards of behavior. I think she's molded the standards of behavior for me over the years. Anyway, where are we at? So defining the values. What's to be expected? What, you know, those are the kind of questions that sometimes we can ask way before they ever get. So I'm going to pick on Sergio just because they're right here. Or I'm going to pick on Matt because they're over here. I think you guys are supposed to be mixed up at table here. We got to mix you up a little differently here so we don't have all this little click here. So surgery folks, before somebody ever comes and is interviewed by you guys, HR is going to go through some of those questions. Some of those things are going to, you know, be pre-screened. And they're going to be behavioral based. They're going to be expectation based. They may not be behavioral based specifically to surgery, but to our culture, to our standards. I think last time when I was here, I talked about standards some. Did I talk about standards last time? Standards are what? Standards do two things. They either confine you, or they define you. We talk about standards, it's like a fence. In my backyard, I have a fence, 6 foot, you know, wooden fence. And to my dog, that fence confines him to the property. And if he can speak, so I think he does sometimes, it sounds like Scooby-Doo. If he can speak, he'd probably say, I feel so confined. I see all those trees in the woods behind, I want to go run there, but you've confined me. But to my neighbors, my fence defines my property line. It keeps them out. I don't mean negatively, like I don't want them there. I mean, it just says, hey, this is my culture, my world, my environment. So when we think about standards of our organization, HR is that fence that says, here's the standards, here's the people we're going to let in, because this is what defines us as an organization. When we talk about ADED as a standard, we talk about acknowledging people, that's what defines us as a culture. I was at the airport yesterday in Tulsa. I went to get something to eat at the counter. And this girl who was working at the counter, I walked up, I said, hey, how's it going? She's still looking down, just kind of went, hey, just kept doing her thing, right? No acknowledgement. That's not what we have here. That's not what ADED says. We acknowledge people. We look at them. We have eye contact. We say something. We introduce ourselves, right? So that's our standard. That's what defines us. HR does that in a lot of ways from a cultural organizational standpoint. Now, it doesn't mean you guys won't do the same thing, but yours is more focused on so the best predictor of future behavior is past behavior. Now I get it. People change. People can get better. But if you're hiring people and we're doing the peer interview process and we're asking behavioral-based questions, questions that say, tell me, you know, not just, have you ever had this situation? And Gina says, yeah. Tell me about that. And she just makes up something because she can. And say, tell me a time when you had this happen and how did you handle it and what did you do about it? That gets much more specific. Now, there's some people that could probably BS their way through some of that. I get it. Talented politicians out there. But the fact is, we have to also be skilled at being able to understand those what they're saying and whether it's true or how true it is and how it applies. So when we talk about the cultural fit, talk about technical skills, talk about the values, there's a leader interview, which is the leader of the department. So which one of you is the leader? Brenda, I love when I catch my mouthful right there. So Brenda's a leader, right? She might do a particular interview as a leader. Then the peers, the ladies, are doing a second interview. So there's a little bit of a screening process. We got a screening process with HR, we got a screening process with Brenda, then we got a screening process, or we got a screening interview process. So it's multifaceted. It's going to take a lot to get in the surgery department. Okay. Which one of you, who's the leader? You are. Jan does an interview, the rest of the team does an interview. It's going to take a lot to get a lap. A couple of barriers to go through to break through. So we've got behavioral-based questions versus non-behavioral-based questions. Behavioral-based questions are very open-ended. It's the same thing we teach when we talk about rounding on patients. When we round on patients, we don't say, were our nurses wonderful? And they go, yes, because we're leading them into the right answer. We say, tell me about our nurses. They don't know what the right answer is, therefore they'll tell you the truth. Patients, they want to be nice. They don't want to get people in trouble, so they want to tell you the truth. People who are being interviewed, they want the job. They're going to tell you the right answer if they know what the right answer is. I like how you said, you know, people, I'm sorry, what's your name? Tammy. Tammy, sorry, Tammy. So I like the way Tammy said, you know, they're coming in very well prepared for these things. They should come in well prepared. That's a good sign, honestly. But they also can come in kind of knowing what the buzzwords or the right answers are. So we have to be very attuned to that as well. When I got hired at StuderGroup, before I got hired at StuderGroup and I had to go for this psychological exam, Sperduto Associates in Atlanta, I Googled everything I could about psychological exams. How do you prepare for them? What kind of questions do they ask? Guess what? There was nothing. I was so disappointed. I'm thinking, I'm going to go in, I'm going to fail, I'm not going to get this job. You know, I'm getting ready to retire from the military, I'm not going to get a job. And there was nothing. And I walked into this interview, and he's asking me all these questions. And Chris and I are still good friends today because I see him at other hospitals. It's kind of funny that he'll be at other partner hospitals while he's doing the same kind of thing. And he's asking me these questions. You know what? Finally, you know, the first couple of answers, you're like thinking, did I give the right answer? Did I not give the right answer? Finally, you just kind of go, I'm just going to tell him the truth. Because when you have an open-ended question, it usually leads to the truth. When we lead, so we don't want to lead people in the interview. Lawyers would call that leading the witness. We don't want to lead them into the answer. We want them to tell them the truth. Other things. Always requires an example or a story. And it's got to be legitimate, and you can tell when somebody's making up a story versus something that really happened in the world. It's got to be a little more difficult to answer, not just simple yes and no, not just, you know, two-sentence answers. It's got to be almost a explanation of the situation. Non-behavioral, hypothetical things. What they would do versus what they have done. Now, if you're hiring somebody who's 18, 19, 22 years old, maybe just out of high school, just out of college, whatever, probably not going to be a lot of experiences. And so you have to base your questions on, tell me a time in the work environment when you did blah, 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 and they're like, I've been in college for the last 4 years, I haven't had a job. Then it might be, tell me a situation in your dorm where this difficult happened and you dealt with this, whatever, right? So you kind of have to modify those questions based on the experience. You know, so Chris just got hired here. Chris hadn't worked in healthcare previously in a healthcare facility, has some familiarity with healthcare, but not in a healthcare facility. You're not going to ask him about some clinical question about how he handled some patient who did something. He hadn't had patients before. He had prisoners, he used to work with the prison, you know. Might be even better to ask that question than with a patient. Some patients might feel like prisoners. I don't know. Yes or no questions. We limit those. To have you ever had experience like this? Yes. Then you go, tell me about how you did this, or this, or that. That might be, you might use a screening question as a yes or no, but that would be the one. So things like this. Tell me about a time when you were the only person on duty, you had to care for multiple patients. How did you prioritize your work? That's an interesting way to put it, right? You're going to get some truth on that. Describe a time when you had a miscommunication with a team member. What did you do and what was the outcome? Now here's where you're listening for different things. You ask a question like that, you're listening for the we they. Did they take responsibility for the miscommunication? Did they blame the other person? One of my hospitals I coached a while back, not a partner of ours anymore, one of the candidates for the chief nursing job at that hospital, she didn't get the job as a chief nurse, and she was kind of frustrated with where she was, and so she wanted to apply to be a StuderGroup coach. And, you know, I won't discourage people from pursuing things that they think they're good about. I didn't really think she was a great fit, but that's not me to determine. And she applied for the job. She got to one or two of the interviews. And when she started complaining about her current CEO, that was a negative influencer. That was, in fact, when I got the call from one of our coaches who said, hey, Mark, you know this person, you know, she interviewed, here's some of the things she said. I said, oh, yeah, I can understand that. You know, I don't say those things to my colleagues prior to those interviews because I don't want to influence them. But they called and asked, and I said, yeah. But that's a key. When you talk about a team member and you start really talking down, managing them down or whatever, that's probably a good key. They're probably not going to get anything. What process or techniques have you learned to make your job easier? Wouldn't that be great? They came with 3 or 4 ideas on making their processes better that they instituted in a previous facility. That's a good sign. Here's the acronym. You always got to have an acronym for everything, right? So here, they've got to tell you the experience or the event. They've got to tell you the action that they did in the event, and then the result of that. Those are 3 categories, 3 keys. When you ask an open-ended, behavioral-based question, if you don't get all 3 of these, you probably don't have a very good answer. Now, you may not get all 3. At that point, if we don't get all 3, sometimes we got to dig a little bit deeper. You mentioned this, but you didn't really tell me what the result of that was. So tell me the outcome. Because you know what, Timmy, other than some people coming in prepared for that, most of them aren't going to come in going, okay, I'm going to give you the event, I'm going to give you, the action. They're just going to tell you. But you have to know this in order to make sure we cover everything with any question. That make sense? Okay. Tell me about a time when you went above and beyond the call of duty to get a job done. Please be as specific as possible. Here's some keywords for you. Remember the keywords my daughter used when she wanted me to help her with the paper? Leadership, right? Here's a keyword. Specific as possible. In my last job, we were preparing for a DMV, which I don't even know what a DMV inspection is. What is that? Probably not healthcare thing. Okay. When one of my coworkers quit, I needed to work an additional 6 hours a day for 2 weeks until the inspection was over. It was stressful, but we did well on the inspection. I just did what I needed to do, and it turned out okay. Now, to me, that's a little bit of a limited answer, in my opinion. It's not my example. I would have gone a little bit more detail about what that person did during that time, other than just work 6 extra days a week. But I like the fact that they're honest enough to say it was really stressful, but I did it, and the outcome was good, and it was worth it. That's pretty good. Here's where you probe for additional information. When you have an incomplete event or action or result, they didn't quite tell you. And you guys who round on patients are probably really good at this. Because you go around on your patients, your nurses especially, you go around on your patients, and you hear things like, nurses are wonderful. Well, what's wonderful about them? Oh, they're just so good to me. Well, what did they do that's really good? Well, they got me this, or they did this before I even asked for it. Now we're getting specific. You see how specific you have to be in this interview. It's not just simply, tell me a time, and they go, I went above and beyond, and I worked 6 extra hours. No, tell me what you did and how that had, what the action was and how. Make sense? So what I told you, some of you have run into that with your employees when you're around them. What's working really well? Oh, we're such a team here. Big deal. Aren't you supposed to be a team here? What is it that teamwork that was really good? So I might ask, what's your name?
Dawn.
So Dawn might say, Dawn, tell me, what did Tom do specifically that led to that good teamwork? Then Dawn is forced to tell me what Tom did. So when I recognize Tom, I'm recognizing for very specific behavior. Same thing here. Improper ear, no ear. Weird to say ear, like you're saying pick it off and hand it to yourself. Qualifying words. Would, should, usually, always, generally. So these are kind of words that that make us think I need to ask a clarifying question. Okay? Lack of specific examples. What else? Further information about the event. Could you be more specific? Give me a specific time when you use that approach. And some of you may be in situations where you can be very, very specific on a process or an approach or something that you might do. Let me use the lab, for example, if I can even remember back to working in a lab. So if I said something about a blood bank procedure, you know, giving out a unit of blood, and there's a certain process that goes through, and let's say, for instance, the OR didn't have that process, you know, down pat, and it's a standard process that we might use, and I'm using generalities right now because I can't remember all the specifics when I used to be in the lab. How did you handle that nurse or that surgeon who was demanding that we have blood and we didn't have it ready because the process wasn't followed? That's a very specific department type of question. Does that make sense? So again, those things are going to be very specific to the events and the ways that things happen in Europe. Who does security here? What is your name?
Mike.
So Mike does security. You know, there might be some tough situations out there security folks have to handle in a hospital. You get some psychiatric patients or psychiatric family members with your patients. You know how that goes sometimes. And so you might be very specific. So tell me a time when you worked in your last hospital when you had a call to the emergency room because they had a patient who needed to be handcuffed and locked down or jumped down or, you know, whatever you guys do to take them down. Tell me how that went. Now, I'm not going to ask that question in the surgery department because hopefully it never happened in the surgery department, but it might have happened in the security department. Maybe. You never know. All right. Can you give a specific example when this happened? What were the circumstances? So here's another opportunity to dig a little deeper. Tell me the circumstances again. So then you kind of know they're not making it up. Because at that point, either they have to make up a lot more circumstances, and then you kind of get them into the where they're really telling their stories, or it really truly did happen. So again, probing a little bit deeper. We've got to be able to really dig. Because again, remember this. Lab folks, that person who gets hired is going to be your responsibility. It's not going to be not hers, not solely on her. See, here's the way things used to work. I came in, I applied to be a lab tech. Jan hires me, interviews me, she hires me. She's solely responsible if I can't get along with these guys. And then they all talk about each other, to each other, like, I can't believe she hired him. How'd she hire him? He's awful. He thinks we're still in the military here. I don't know, whatever. But if she does the interview and she thinks I'm a pretty good fit, then she has the rest of us in the rest of the parent team do the interview. Then if they hire me and I don't work out, then they can talk about it to each other and go, well, can you believe she hired him? And then, you know, Gina would say to Mike, well, Mike, we kind of did the interview too. We're kind of responsible here. And that happens. I have my hospital in Arkansas, same thing. Did the peer interview for a new nurse. I mean, all five people on the interview team agreed unanimous, because you want it to be a unanimous decision. Yes, this is the right hire. Within 3 weeks, they got rid of this person. They're like, what in the world did we do? How did this person get by all of us? That's what happens. Yeah. What was the most memorable time of the event? Further information about the action. So that was specifically about the event, about the action. Tell me specifically how you did that. Exactly what did you do? Again, because you can tell when somebody's using generalities. When one of your employees doesn't really want to get specific because they can't think of what's working really well, or who they need to recognize, they'll talk in generalities. And finally, if they're good at it, they'll just keep doing it until you get frustrated and move on to the next question. Same thing with our interview. Walk me through the steps you took. What did you do first, second, third? What was your role? Now here's another opportunity. If you're hiring somebody whose role is going to be generalist, lab tech, bench tech. But the example they gave was when they took leadership into their own hands and made some things happen, that might be a good sign. If they were a lab supervisor in another position, and they're coming here to be a lab supervisor, but the examples are things when 15 years ago when they were a bench tech, and not as a supervisor, that's a good indication it might not be the right thing. Exactly what part did you play? So we got the screening process, we get to the leader interview. I know we're going through this kind of fast. We got about half an hour before we're going to wrap up here. During the interview, a leader explains a day in the life of. Here's where the expectations come in. And we talked about those expectations. Here's what it looks like. And literally, I can remember this. And I'm only using my own example because when I was in military, again, remember, I didn't do this kind of hiring. So I'm teaching you based on my experiences as getting hired and my knowledge of this particular subject. So understand that I'm not like somebody who's been in HR for 20 years doing the hiring process. That's my person. But I remember this so distinctly when people like Judy Keyes and Renee Wright and Stephanie Baker were interviewing me on the phone. Mark, do you understand the travel schedule? Do you understand how, and I would say, I've been in the military for 20 years. I've traveled all over the world. It's no big deal. No, Mark, do you understand that there's times when you leave on Monday morning and you don't come back till Saturday morning? There's times, Mark, when you're going to be in four different states, four different cities, 4 days in a row. Of course, what am I going to say? Oh, yeah, because I want to get hired. But every single one of those five interviews went so deeply into that one thing because they knew the one thing we lose coaches in the student group is for travel. It's not because the job's hard. I mean, there are times when it's hard, maybe I'm going wrong. But it's the travel. Like last night, I didn't get into 1 o'clock this morning. Because flight delays, I go through Atlanta instead of Minneapolis. I'm only going used to that. I sleep on a plane. I know how to make these things happen. I'm good at it now. But had that happened my first week, 4 years ago when I started, I might have said to my wife, I wouldn't have said out loud to anybody else, I think I need to find another job. And she'd say, no, you don't, because you're making money now. You got to keep this job. So I cannot stress to you anymore, as a leader, and as a leader, and others in the department, you have got to set the expectation. And even if you have to have people walk through that day with you, I wish in StuderGroup we could have people actually go on the road, shadowing another coach for a week, like on a really busy week, and say, this is what we do, this is how we run from gate to gate in an airport, do the O.J. Simpson thing, jumping over suitcases. Not the O.J. Simpson thing, you know, doing the wrong coaches. By the way, not the O.J. Simpson thing. Anybody watching that show on, is it on FX now or TNT or one of those? I haven't watched it, I'm sure people probably don't. Anyway, so the leader has got to validate the skills. The leader validates the abilities to do the job. Now remember, the peer interview team, the peers are not necessarily assessing the skills and the abilities of the technical part of the job. The leader's going to do that a lot more. So understand the difference in role. Not that you might not be interested in that, but that should be, you should have screened, Jan, that I'm qualified as a lab tech to be part of this team. It means cultural stuff here, the peers are the ones that are going to really see if I fit well. So if I get past Jan, then they're gonna dig a little deeper than that. So during the interview, we're looking for alignment to desired behaviors. How do you fit skill-wise, abilities, and a little bit of the culture? Top 10 best practices. Here we go. Select questions in advance. Why is it important to have to know the questions in advance? Why? Well, so that everybody's on the same page. Everybody's using this. So when these guys are all asking questions, they all know what the questions are. We're prepared. We're in alignment. It's not like all of a sudden one's asking a question, the other goes, well, why'd you ask that question? You know? What does that have to do with it? We have to agree to the questions in advance. It's not just the leader, but for everybody, really. Select the questions in advance. Know what questions you're going to ask. Have that well thought out. And I would even encourage you, as a department, now again, you're going to get trained more and more and more on this and such. But as a department, I think you really need to role play and practice this together before you ever bring another person in. Because you guys know the department best. You know your job best. You know each other really well. And so if we're asking the questions of each other that we would ask of somebody else, that's good practice. Use the same questions for each candidate. So you might get 12 people that came through. It's important we have exactly the same questions for all 12. How else do you measure if you don't ask exactly the same thing? Now you have to be careful because some of them may lead you astray in their answers, but you've still got to come back to the original questions. Number 3, be prepared, be prompt. Establish the model of our standards and values. Our standards are being on time all the time, be on time. Our standards are being prepared, be prepared. I hope that you would not go to an interview unprepared, and then that sets the stage for that person either to not be prepared themselves, and or think, do I really want to work here? They're not even prepared for my interview. How are they going to be prepared for my job? Number 4, establish rapport. Remember, this is your opportunity to connect with them. Find something to connect. Get to know them a little bit. You know, don't just jump right into the interview. If you just jump right into the interview, we're not accomplishing a whole lot. You got to get to know them. Just like grounding, right? We got a little bit of a icebreaker relationship kind of thing. Hey, how's the family kind of thing? Tell me about yourself, where'd you come from, whatever. Establish rapport. Listen for specific examples. Remember, we're looking for very specific things. You can see that when we coach these kind of things, there's a lot of similarities to a lot of the other things we coach. When I talk about specifics in rounding on patients or rounding on your staff, I talk about specifics in interview. It's the same thing. Number 6, probe for more ear info. It just sounds so weird to say that. Probe for more ear info. Like you're looking for earwax or something. I don't know what you're probing for. Here's where your critical thinking skills come into line. The critical thinking skills are not always so common, but we've got to develop those if we don't have a lot of money. Number 7, what we're going to do. Take notes. I can't emphasize this enough, that you have got to write down what you hear them say. And I can guarantee you, all 4 of you are going to write down different things. Because you hear things different. I can guarantee, Chris, you and I are going to write things down a lot different than what you do. We hear things different. I was literally in a session last week. I coach. One of the places, did you mention that I coached in Nantucket Island? I don't think you mentioned that one, did you? So I was in Nantucket last week. What an awful place, the double job I have, right? Hawaii in January coaching in Colorado. So I combine vacations with coaching. So I Colorado skiing, but I'm coaching at the same time as going to LDI. I go to Nantucket last week. That's my regular hospital. I get to go there about 3 times a year. I'm sitting around a table with their leaders. This is how important those are. I've got 6 leaders around the table. One's the CEO of some of their, what they call their kind of service excellence team, devising what their next, they're up for renewal in our contract and devising what that contract's going to look like and how many coaching days we're going to have and what's the focus going to be. I'm listening to this person. I'm taking notes. I'm writing things down. Listen to this one. Taking notes. Writing things down. All the way around the table. As soon as they get done, now it's my turn to talk. I turn over to this. I look right at the person. The notes I wrote, I said, here's what I heard you say, blah, 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 blah. This was the gentleman sitting. This was a one, and it was all ladies the rest of the way. Gentleman, he nods his head, yep, that's what I said. I go to the lady, I say, this is what you said, this is what I'm talking about. Next one, nobody says a word to me. He nods his head, nobody else says anything. I talk to the CEO the next day. First thing she says to me, Mark, it was a good discussion yesterday, but the team felt like you weren't listening. I was like, she probably looked at me, and my jaw probably dropped, like, are you kidding me? I was taking notes, I even reiterated what I took in my notes, and nobody said anything to me. The one gentleman nodded his head, but nobody else, I look back now, I think nobody else nodded their head. I guess that they didn't agree with me. I took notes, and I still didn't get it right, at least in their mind, in their perception. I get it. I thought I was taking pretty good notes. I thought I'd take pretty good notes. I thought I listened pretty well. Apparently, I don't. Of course, I've been told that for 28 years at home, but I don't think she knows what goes on in my job, but apparently she does. It's just amazing. So I'm telling you, that's why I can't emphasize to you enough that the notes that you take are so important, and that you, all four of you get done interviewing, that you look at your notes, you say, I wrote this down. Oh, I missed that. But I wrote this down. Oh, I missed that. But talk about that. Because we're going to hear things differently, and we're going to perceive things differently. That's the whole great opportunity we have, that all four of you get to be part of that process. You can't just blame Jenny for not hiring somebody. Okay. Number 8. Applies to number 7 in my case, right? Listen, 80%, talk 20%. I literally let them go around the whole table, it's so hard for me. You can talk about patience. Hard for me to be patient and not say something right away. I'm taking these notes, I'm listening, I want to respond to it. I can't, I gotta wait until they go all around the table. I listen, at least 90% of the time, I think. Still getting it right. Just being honest with you, you know? I mean, I know Mark Noon, I've not been a great listener my whole life. But I really try. I mean, I really try to focus. I'm listening. I know ADD, so I may run off on a squirrel every now and then, but I come back. Number 9, allow for silence. So here's this key. This is hard for us talkers. Jenny, I'm gonna ask you a question about a time that you did whatever. I want you to tell me how that experience went. And then she's thinking about it, and I'm waiting. How long can we wait? Number 11. They say the magical number, and I don't know, I read on the internet somewhere, so it must be true. The magical number is like 12 seconds. I don't know, statistically, that's what, I read it on the internet, but it is statistically like Gallup research kind of thing. 12 seconds to wait for an answer. Now, I've got to give Jenny some time to think about what her answer is going to be. But we're not patient enough, I'm not patient enough a lot of times to do that. I do this in my family. Oh, my gosh. My daughter Hannah, so the one I told you, use the keywords so we can help her. She was riding in the car with me last 2 weekends, or at least a weekend they were home. Riding in the car with me, sitting in the back seat. I can't see her facial expressions. I can't see if she thinks. I ask her a question. She doesn't answer me in about 3 seconds. I'm like, Hannah, are you listening to me? I asked her a question. Literally, that's what I did. My wife's sitting in the car too. She's like, Mark, give her time to think about the answer. Okay. 5 seconds, is that enough time? my mind is, I ask a question, I want an answer. It shouldn't just be that quick. Like when I Google, it tells you, Google how long it takes you to get the answers, like 1.27 seconds or something. That's what I want. I want a Google answer. Or at least a pick list that I can turn to whatever the answer is. We have, the interview process, if you're anything like me, you've got to slow down, let them give an answer. Listen to the entire answer. Don't interrupt. Because they may stop talking for a second to think some more, We took time to do it. Not an easy thing to do for those of us that are a little ADD or talk a lot. Last one, feedback to HR. I say within 24 hours, again, you guys need to establish that as an organization, but that's best practice. Once we're done with that interview, we need to talk about, again, it may take several days while we interview. So we're not going to get feedback to HR the next day after the first interview. Wait till interviews are done. We have our discussion. Who do we think? What do we think? Why do we think this? That needs to come back to HR pretty quickly. Don't you have timelines on hiring? Don't we typically have like so many days after something we have to get to the next stage? Because we don't want to take 6 months to hire somebody. You know, but we don't want to rush into it tomorrow either. So be cognizant of the time frame where you're at. All right, what's next? Develop the interview process. We're going to review the job description, review your evaluation tool. This, again, is the process. And this is going to be done by your interview team. This is just some highlights for you. Identify the characteristics of a top performer. What does a top performer in this organization look like? What does a top performer in your department look like? So, again, in your mind, you're thinking of some of those people in your department that are high performers. What does that look like? What do they do? So when you think about crafting your questions or bringing the questions off the interview sheet or determining what's right for the hire, think about the best performers you have. What are those characteristics? Wouldn't you love to hire only high performers? What I love about StuderGroup, I think, and again, this is not Mark Newton saying this because I got hired by StuderGroup, but we hire high performers. When you have 400 applicants, you can really screen really, really well. Now, when you don't have any applicants or you're limited in applicants, maybe a little harder to do that. But do we have to hire somebody if we don't have qualified people? Review your standards behavior. Using the standard behavior interview library, identify the competencies you're looking for. Today, when we do the practice, we're going to split the room. We're going to half the room's going to do the interview while the other half's doing it, and we're going to swap. We're going to actually walk through some of these interviews, and I have certain questions I picked out that I think are probably the best overall questions for any department. Not going to be real specific. We're going to deal with creativity. We're going to deal with critical thinking. We're going to deal with decision making. So it's things like that. We got to make sure that that's the direction we're going. What level are we hiring for? Are we hiring an entry level person? Are we hiring a supervisor? Are we hiring somebody in a leadership position? The questions are going to be very different. Questions, do's and don'ts. HR, tell me these things are right or wrong. I think they're pretty specific. Almost kind of getting really difficult in the question process today. There's a lot of changes happening in our society that maybe some of these questions are even becoming a bigger concern, a bigger influencer. Are you not supposed to ask things like, you know, a single young lady, is there any chance you get married anytime soon? Or in my area, it'd be like, any chance you're marrying a military person who's gonna move out of the area? You can't ask those kind of questions, right? Kind of go okay. Some of the other things that are on there, religion, politics. You know, it's really almost hard to get through any day without talking about politics with all that's going on in the political world today. What kind of car or house do you have? You know, not those kind of things. Yes, ma'am, sure.
Citizenship.
Cannot ask that. Well, according to HR, tell me if I'm wrong, the citizenship of a legitimate question. Or would they even get to that process in the interview without meeting? Yeah, and I don't know all the legal rules on that, and it's probably varies by state to state right now. So, but that's a very good question. I'm guessing, if they've even got to that point in the interview process, if you're interviewing, Sherry, this is already not a concern. Because you got probably a lot of foreign applicants, don't you? Yeah, I understand that. Anything else in there that jumps out at you that might be a concern, or you might think, hey, what's... Why would we not do that? All right, good. When in doubt, don't. Yes?
I guess the one just caught my attention. How long have you lived in an area?
How long you lived in an area is... I'm sorry, your name again.
Mike.
Mike, sorry, Mike. Why would that be a don't when it comes to the questions? How would that be an influencer? Anybody? HR?
Could tell you their age.
Could tell you their age? Yeah. What else?
If you're trying to recruit somebody in this county,
be an influencer? We don't want somebody local? Yeah. Is it?
Yeah, they actually asked me that in my interview.
Oh, they did? Okay. I wonder if you hired it now? Yeah, but how long you live somewhere is not necessarily where you live. Yeah.
You know, I guess often as I would, sometimes they bring me a sense of itself.
Sure.
And so is it okay to then talk to them about if they've initiated it?
Sure. Well, and I would say, yeah. I mean, if they've asked, if they say, well, I've lived in the area for 20 years, you might say, oh, well, hey, that's great. I've lived here for 15 years, you know. I think, you know, again, these are, I don't think that all these are necessarily legal don'ts. Some of these are just not necessarily go down the road because we could get ourselves in trouble. Somebody offers how old they are. Oh, well, I'm about the same age. You might talk about it at that point. They offered it. I don't think that's a big deal. But if you ask them, how old are you? And then they tell you, and you go, oh, gosh, I can't that old. I need you here for a while, you know. All right. What else? So starting the interview, keywords. Introduce yourself. ADIT. Why would we not do ADIT immediately in an interview as our standard behavior? Acknowledge who they are. Obviously, you're going to do that. You're going to introduce yourself. Introduce yourself. Tell how long you worked here. Tell your role. Other roles you have in the organization. Give them an understanding of the opportunities that exist here. If you've been in four different positions in this organization because you were an entry level at this place and you went into this department as a supervisor and then you got promoted to a manager in this department, let them know that. Let them know there's opportunities here. I think it's good. That's a positive thing. What's the duration of the interview? Tell them the duration of the interview. This interview's going to take about 45 minutes. Part of ADIT, right? What's the explanation? Here's what's going to happen today. All three of us are going to ask you questions. We all have three different questions we're going to ask you. You know, you have to tell them right at that point what the questions are. Tell them what the questions are. And then what, at the end, what do we do at the end? Thank you. Thank you so much. Oh, and what did we learn last time we were here about, what's the other thing we added to ADIT? So what kind of promise would we add in the interview process initially to introduce ourselves to somebody?
You'll hear back from us.
Yes, you'll hear back from us in so many days. It wouldn't be, I promise you, if you get through this interview, you'll get hired. What else can we promise in the interview? As an example of our standard behavior. I mean, doing the whole ADIT plus the promise, what would we do? What else would we do? Promise to be respectful of your time. Yeah. So think about those kind of things. And again, here's the thing, ADIT works everywhere. Every situation. And wouldn't it be great if that was the standard that they saw immediately in the hiring process? Wow, they really take some time to explain to me. Other keywords. An interview asks questions about job or life. How would you have handled them? I'll be taking notes. Let them know you're taking notes. Just like we do. Here's, let me go back to rounding on this one, rounding on our staff. I'm rounding on Jenny. Jenny, I'm going to write this down so I don't forget it. I'm telling her why I'm writing it down. I'm paying attention to you. I'm taking notes. Tell people that. I want to take notes so I remember the things that you said. There aren't any right or wrong answers. Just be honest with your answer. Keywords. Use specific candidate words and examples in your notes. Good answer is not an acceptable note. It doesn't tell you anything. I do this. Sometimes I get so caught in this when I'm doing validations, like if I'm running with the nurses on a department and I'm validating, and you got the checklist, the competency checklist, and I'll put things like good answer or good feedback, and then I'll go back to the when after we're done with the process, and I sit down with the nurse director or the CNO, and I said, well, I put good feedback here, but I didn't put what the feedback was, and I can't remember it because I ran it with 16 different people over there. Good answer is not an acceptable note. Use notes to support the numbers. So again, we're gonna look at the decision matrix. The decision matrix. Do they have a copy of that on the table, Derek?
Yes.
It should be part of your packet. So it's a decision matrix. We'll pull that part of your packet out. It's a. Do I have a copy of it right here? Okay. The decision matrix is called. There's like a blanks, and then there's numbers next to those blanks. Got that?
Page 8.
So pay attention to the numbers. The numbers are important. The numbers are a ranking or a rating based on the answers that the person gives in the interview. So when you're writing those notes and you're putting down a number, you have the ability then to go back and add up the numbers. Here's what happened one time. This is not a decision matrix, but let me tell you how the same process works. I had a supervisor in the hospital I worked at. I was a lieutenant in Kansas. My first assignment as a lab director, I was up for a big award for the entire base. I had won the award for my hospital as the officer of the quarter. I was up for the junior officer of the quarter for the entire base. My boss happened to be on the board that did the interviews and did the process. She was one of the four members on the board. They went through the interview process. I interviewed with each, almost like a peer selection, only they asked me questions about the accomplishments I had and whatever. And then they ranked me. They ranked the numbers. They got done with the interview, and they added up all the numbers, and here's what happened. They added up all the numbers, and my number came out second to somebody else's. And they all looked at each other like, how did he come out second? We thought he had, they thought, she's telling me this later, thought I had the best interview, I had the best, should have had the best numbers. But by the scoring system, based on each individual interview, I came out second. But, and the integrity said, well, we scored this other guy higher, we're going to give him the award, because it's the right thing to do. That's why that score is so important. We need to keep track of that score, because you're in the moment at that point. You're not comparing everybody to everybody, you're comparing it to the notes that you took and the interview process that took place. So that scoring system you have there is very, very important. Use that. When you don't have all the answers, you're not asking the right questions, just remember that. Close the interview, thank the candidate. Now talk about what the next steps are. You know, Sherry said this. You're going to hear from us in X number of days. That doesn't mean you got the job. You'll hear back from us. We let everybody know whether they got hired or if they didn't. Here's the time frame. Here's the next step, whatever that might be. If you make it to the next step, here's what it'll be. You should hear from this. Be gracious. They're going to want to share. They're going to share their impression of you as an organization to all their friends. That's why that aid at the beginning is so important. Building that rapport, getting that relationship with them is so important in the beginning, because that's their perception. Whether you hire them or not, their perception is their perception. They're going to tell the community. Isn't that just like our patients? Doesn't matter. Their perception is their perception. Other tips, be aware of your body language. If you're sitting back in the chair, the other day I was talking with the CEO in their office. And I went to lean back in the chair. And I wasn't leaning back like I was going to, like a recliner. I was just leaning back to put my back against the chair to be a little more comfortable. And the back of the chair was like broken, so it like bent me way back. And I felt like I was sitting there, like I was sort of had my feet up talking to the CEO. So, after a couple seconds of that, and I was actually kind of comfortable, but after a couple seconds, I went, this is probably not the best impression as a coach I should have with the CEO of the hospital. So I, stood up, or sat up, so I wasn't touching the back of the chair. I would have hoped that the CEO would have figured out that his chair was broken and would have replaced it with somebody else with another. Control the interview. Again, control the time, control what's going on. You will get people in the interview who will be very talkative. And I think sometimes, Tammy, going back to your thing, being very prepared, they might talk really a lot about a subject because they really don't have a good answer, so they just keep talking. Sometimes you got to say, okay, I get it. That's enough. Thank you. You got to be correct. Don't you have to be that with some of your patients when you're rounding on them? That's exactly it. So, again, think of the interviewee as one of your patients sometimes, how that goes. Or some of your friends. My dad was visiting the same time my girls were home for Easter. My dad, oh my gosh. My wife finally told me, Mark, just go in your office and close the door. Doesn't matter if you're even working, just go in there and close. Because my dad would follow me into my office. And I'd be sitting on my computer starting to work. He'd just be talking. Blah, 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 blah. Just talking about it. My dad just talks about everything. Doesn't have any purpose, just talk. Imagine where I get it from, right? And I'm like trying to get him, like I'm on my computer. So finally, I got to make up things like, yeah, I think I got a phone call coming up. Well, it's not for 4 hours, but I don't tell him that. I just got a phone call coming up. So sometimes you got to control things. Everything you hear is confidential. Let them know that. Let them know. The things you share with us today are confidential. This team only, we're the ones that are going to know that. They're not even going to share all those details with HR. They're not going to share it. They're just going to, it's confidential to make their decision. All right, retention starts once the offer is made. So once we actually hire, or we've offered somebody the job, that's when retention starts. We cannot just say our job's over. We're done. We've hired them. Because what's the highest turnover rate in the hospital? First year and or 90 days. Some hospitals differ. Retention starts immediately. 64% of those that leave within the first 3 years, 34% the first year, and 11% in the first 90 days. Top reasons for leaving. Relocation, I get it. Sometimes we're not always happy in the environment or the area we live. Personal reasons. You know what personal reasons usually is? They don't like your boss. The expectations are different than what you told them they were. Or the outcomes are different than they expected. If they put personal reasons, or HR folks, you guys do exit interviews? Isn't all HR here? Right? Yeah. Or not all HR? You're like, they don't hear you. Yeah. So HR, we do exit interviews? Yeah. Did they ever say, I don't like my boss? They don't usually say that. I mean, sometimes. But most of the time they don't. They say personal reasons. Other. If you were a probe deeper, if you were actually asking, or if you saw them at Walmart, would you read? My boss. I didn't like working. What else? Career advancement. And again, remember millennials? This three-year thing is going to go considerably up over the next several years as millennials continue to take over more marketplace. And believe me, please understand that. It's not an indictment against, it's just a fact. It's just the observation. Job price is not as I expected. Mismatch between job, blah, blah, blah. You've got those in your notes. We don't have to go over those because I'm running just a little short on time. So I'm going to get you lunch. It's just me and between you and lunch. 30 day, you guys do 30, 90 day conversations after people are hired? So important. 30 days, what do you do at 30 days? I round on them. Kelly, what's working well? Who do we need to recognize? You know, who's going to do your job? The processes we need to fix. Has it been like I told you it's going to be? Have we met your expectations? Have we exceeded your expectations? Is it different than you thought? Took the opportunity to say that to me. Well, Mark, you told me it was going to be like this, and it really hasn't been. Okay, now I have an opportunity to fix that in the first 30 days instead of waiting until the probation period's over and or they decide to leave. 90-day conversation is exactly the same, except what? What's the one thing we add on to the 90-day conversation? If they're a really good employee. Let me add that part. You passed your probation period. We want to do the interview at 89 just in case. So. High performers only, or really good performers only, what's the one question we add to the 90-day? If you've done 30, 90 days, you know this. What is it? What? Well, you want to be recruited, yes, but there's one question that's extra on the 90-day versus the 30-day. Is there anybody else you think would be a good fit for this organization to come work here? Because if you hired a high performer and in that first 90 days they have excelled abundantly, if they just excelled abundantly, they probably have friends who are really good at the job as well. Or maybe they came from another hospital and they say, yeah, I got a friend over there. They can't stand working there either. I think they'd be a great fit here. That's HR. That's your number one hiring opportunity. You don't have to recruit anymore. You can just have people who are brand new here bring in new recruits for you. Physicians, Jerry? We get some physicians who love it here, do a 90-day.
I send out a questionnaire.
Yeah, but I would absolutely encourage face-to-face conversation. Because what we're going to gain there is the opportunity to recruit new physicians. Because especially if they're brand new out of medical school and we're hiring them, and they're really, really good, chances are they hung around with the really, really good ones at medical school who went somewhere else and found out that wasn't a great place to work and we wanted to come here. What else? How do we compare what we said? That's the 30-day thing, 90-day thing. The extra question, who do you think would be a good fit? We said that. All right, hardwiring this. When you hire somebody, Kelly, you hire somebody, they start April 6th, 2016, on your calendar, on May 5th, 6th, one of those days, we need to set aside 30-day conversation time. Or if it doesn't work out before, don't wait till the 7th. Try to do it early. Same thing with the 90-day thing. Get to the 90-day point. Here's one of the things we learned when I was in the military about 90 days. After 90 days, when people start to feel, 90 to 120 days, when people start to feel comfortable in your organization, they start to get a little bit lax. That's the time when they need to know that they're important and valued. And if you can find out that they got somebody else who wants to work here, it gets them feeling like they can contribute something to the organization. Closing thoughts. Best decision might not be me to not hire. I don't know who you are, but I will find you and I will hire you. Isn't that one of the best lines in movies ever when he says, I will find you and I will kill you? Of course, when you're a father of when you have children that are female daughters and you watch this movie, of course, you never let them go out anywhere else. Like my daughter's supposed to come with me to DC in May. I told her she can't come unless she's got a friend. Go around the city with her, so she's not going to live by herself. I don't care if she's 22 years old. That's right. I watched this movie too many times. Now I'm thinking I don't want my wife to go anywhere either because I was taking two and taking three. So I'm not sure where I want my wife to go out of the house anyway. I don't want to lose these people. All right. Why might it be a good idea not to hire? I know we're at lunch, so hang with me for a couple seconds. Why might it not be a good idea to hire somebody? I gotta put a face to the face. Mark, we can't keep the doors open if I don't hire somebody. Why might it not be a good idea? Standards aren't as high. What damage can we do to the organization if we do hire this person, even though we say to ourselves, I'm not sure I can make it without them? It's a tough decision, and I'm not telling you the right answer here, because I get it. You hire I got a hospital in Texas, I'm going to be there next week. 180 people in the entire hospital. They have four physicians that are part of the entire medical district. Four, that's it. They lose a family practice physician, that is a quarter of their population that cannot see a doctor in the next 30, 90, 180 days. That doctor's a little disruptive. Are they going to fire him or her? Probably not. But what does it do to the organization? It's really a tough decision, and I don't have the exact answer. That's Steve that has to make that decision at that level. But sometimes the decision not to hire is the best decision you can make. People don't leave jobs, they leave people, so you've got to be a role model. Remember, once they're hired, it's your responsibility to make sure that they're a good hire, and that they adhere to the standards of behavior, and they be who they need to be. All that's in your notes, so I'm not going to add that. I'm going to read all that to you. Let's practice is what we're going to do after lunch. So we're right at that point. Okay. Derek, I'll turn it back over to you.